Well, welcome back to Mages and Sages. This is episode 19 of Interview with the Old Mage with a special guest of Stephen Schend. And we had a really good time with this interview. Stephen's an old friend of mine and Ed's. And it was great to get old friends back together. And hope you really enjoyed as much as we enjoyed recording it. All right, here we are. Interview with the Old Mage, special guest Stephen Schend. Okay, everybody, welcome back to Mages and Sages, Interview with the Old Mage, and today we have Stephen Schend. Stephen Schend was one of the employees back when the TSR days, worked on Dungeons & Dragons products from, what, 1990 to 2001, I think, right, Stephen?
Yeah, pretty much. I did a little bit of freelancing up until, I think, 2002, but...
Right? Terrific. Yeah. Well, welcome to the show here. We do have some design credits, which I want to shout out here for you. Along the Forgotten Realms line, what a City of Splendors, Undermountain, Madgoth's Castle, Lost Level in Undermountain, Lands of Intrigue, Hellgate Keep, Carmanther Empire of the Elves, Wormskull Throne, Skullport, Sea of the Fallen Stars. I'm getting run out of breath here, Stephen. There's Jordan's Guide to the Underdark.
I didn't do that one. That was Eric.
Oh, I thought you did.
I wasn't undressed.
Oh, I thought you worked on it with him.
If I did, it has fallen out of my memory entirely, and I don't have any files in my computer either. So.
Okay, well, Eric, did he work on it with you?
It was inspired. Stephen and I had a lot of phone calls, and he was helping me just like I helped him.
Oh, there you go. Perfect. Thank you. And that's there's Eric Boyd. Yes, we have Eric Boyd. We have Stephen Schend, George Crashos, Curry Russell, Ed Greenwood, the Old Mage, and myself here for this interview.
And just Jerry Mathers as a beaver.
So we'll try to get some kind of interview done here, because this is like having giving the asylums the keys to the asylum, so the inmates the keys to the asylum here. So we're going to try to get through some of these questions. We have quite a few here, so we'll get to them as we can. So, Stephen, first, tell us what got you into wanting to write for Dungeons & Dragons.
Well, honestly, I had been spending the previous year after graduating with an education degree hunting for a job and not landing any. I was just selling clothes part-time and to keep a roof overhead, and decided after, you know, instead of applying for yet another education job, I was sitting there reading Dragon Magazine just to relax my brain and thought, well, what the hell, I'll send in a application to Dragon. And so I did. And 3 weeks later, I get a phone call. Then Roger Ver wants to interview me.
Oh, wow.
And I didn't get that job, but I got called in for another interview with Jim Ward and got the editorial position job. So I started in February of 1990. And honestly, it was just, who knows, maybe that's one of those signals of don't just crank out applications and resumes for any old job, you know, actually care about what you're applying for, and maybe it'll happen. So.
Yeah, but that happy mistake led you to a lifetime of incredible writing.
Yep, it's been fun, and it's been a long and very strange road, but it's been worth it every step of the way.
What's been strange about it, other than Ed?
Oh, I'm not going to name names.
Yeah, I met most of the TSR staff. I was well behaved compared to some. And I visited once a year. Stephen had to go in and be in the same building as all of them every day. He couldn't escape.
Oh, that's right.
Didn't have windows to, you know, that may have just saved us from defenestration, probably.
That little low wall between the designer's floor and down below was awfully tempting.
Some days, yeah, but... and then you'd get the fun days if somebody steals an entire roll of bubble wrap out of the warehouse and Zeb Cook decides, hey, push me along in my desk chair across this stuff. And then Roger sticks his head over trying to figure out why it sounds like machine gun fire downstairs.
I like when Ed sent his original map to Jeff Grubb, and they had to cover up the bathroom wall or the entrance to the bathroom.
No, the floor between the cubes and the ladies' bathroom.
That's what it was, yeah.
And Karen couldn't go and pee. And so I suggested to her that she victimize one of those potted plants and then just empty it over this low wall I was referring to. And she said, that would be on someone's head. And I said, and?
Oh, my God.
It's okay. Like 1991 all over again.
All right, so let's go ahead and go to the first question we have from some of the fans here. You want to go ahead and take that, Curry?
Sure. Let's do it. Nikolai Withander wants to know about the powers of the Grand Staff, preferably in the 3.5 edition rules. He wants to know any or all that you can define. Take a moment to describe whatever you've got on the staff.
Oh, gosh. Well, Ed, since Hilleather is more yours than mine, I will defer to your judgment, but I'm going to read what I have found in my notes here, and then we'll kind of expand from there, okay?
Sure. I know one power right away.
What's that?
I know one power right away, but let's do your list.
All right. I've got an old quote that apparently I wrote in 2004 and have no memory of, but that's okay. You know, there's only so much room in the buffer. So, quote, the Grand Staff of Hilleather is an 86-inch long staff of white ash that seems twisted and knotted, as in tied, not covered in knots. At the top of the staff, the twists become one big whirl, leaving a cavity through which four gems spin and float. These are not iron stones, but something different, as their shapes and colors shift depending on the time of day, depth beneath the earth, and the presence of certain magics and extra-planar creatures. As for what it does, and then I leave a series of dots, which usually should be presented as whatever the GM needs and wants is what it's going to do. Now, given that it's Hilleather, and it's Hilleather before it's Halaster, I'm going to take a random stab that each of the four gems, by what they change, by time and location, they're going to have something to do with, not so much anything to do with Underdark, so much as it's light and darkness. And I'm not quite sure how to work with the depth thing, but that has more to do with him building Undermountain, and this staff had something to do with that. For all I know, maybe the staff doesn't even exist any longer. It's just lodged into part of Undermountain as a control system. I would gather that each of those four gems is at least as powerful as an Elven Kira, if not more so. It's been a long time since I've read up on either what I wrote about the Kira or what Iun stones do, so anyone else feel free to chime in and add an addendum.
Okay, I can give you two powers that I know that it has. It can teleport by touch large amounts of inorganic matter. For instance, when you are hollowing out a room in Undermountain and you have a whole bunch of rubble, you can teleport that rubble out of Undermountain to somewhere else.
Okay, that works.
And that's number one. Number two, far more important, it reveals all gates/portals within the staff holder's sight and 400 feet. Okay, so they have to be able to see them. You can't look around corners or through solid, but it is in a sphere, a 400-foot sphere around the wielder. It reveals them all, and you can use the staff to open a portal, close a portal, seal a portal, and the last thing you can do is you can cast a spell from yourself through the staff, or that is already in the staff, stored in the staff, into the gate where it sits and awaits the next being to pass through the gates, and then is cast on them.
I like that. That's nasty.
I like that, too. Wow.
I might actually add to that, because we know Hilleather was hired during the Shun Imperium, and in the year of the Battle of Tempest.
That's a transformed Shun mage who disagrees with you.
Yeah, he built a tower near Baragos, where Olcaster School of Wizardry was later. And he was hired, basically, to figure out how to bind creatures into objects. And so I think, along with what Ed was saying, there's probably some sort of power that allows him to bind fiends and other creatures into objects themselves.
Okay, I like that. That works. One thought that crossed my mind through both yours and Ed's responses was it would be very useful for this staff to be able to cloak the holder's presence and or whatever activity they're up to. So if we've already got this, say, 400-foot radius that Ed mentioned in regards to being able to spy portals and magics and whatnot, we may as well take that same radius and make it that any noise, vibration, or, you know, effectively it makes a sensory null zone. So anybody outside of that 400-foot radius will not know that this person is there. So no matter how much material they're blasting away at and or teleporting out of the way, no matter how heavy the creature summoned is that's stomping around inside this area, no vibrations will, you know, it's not going to suddenly attract the interest of an Umber Hulk or something like that. So it more or less just masks anything that's going on within the sphere of influence of that staff holder. I know that's a little vague and it's not 3.5 rules, but I've never been so much the rules guy as the story guy, so apologies there.
So is the Grand Staff still, is there still one around? Either, did it get destroyed, I thought?
I honestly cannot remember. Part of the notes I've got here say, let me see here. Stealing or planting relics, artifacts, and items. So Kelvin was more or less shunting things around among the Moonstars and with them. So items hunted and recovered or released by the Moonstars include two of the seven swords of the Schend. Say that 10 times fast. The Tapestry of St. Alaric. That's a Tetherian thing. The Grand Staff of Hilather, and the Black Gauntlet of Vayne's Vengeance. So that...
What, the Black Gauntlet of Vayne's Vengeance.
Yep.
It lives at the bottom of my toilet bowl.
Sometimes you need a plunger of some might.
So what's it, a +5 plunger to get rid of that thing?
You don't want to see what it does to a gelatinous cube, man.
Oh, that's terrific. Well, thank you for the answer. I think Nikolai will be satisfied with that. I know he will be. Okay. All right, so I have one here from Manu Hamilton, and he is, I think this came from the fans page, fans of Ed Greenwood. He loves all your books that you worked on. City of Splendors was amazing, and his question would be, in working with Forgotten Realms and Wizards, who currently controls, of course, we know the lore development, the recent positioning of the Zentarum seems out of touch with the existing lore, in my opinion. How does rectifying historical lore and existing products with new product development work?
That is a question you would have to direct at somebody at Wizards, because I haven't been an employee of Wizards since 2000. And I'm afraid I don't know who would be the person to talk to in regards to who keeps an eye on consistency of lore and adherence to whatever you want to call it. I loathe to use the word canon, but...
Right.
I can tell you what my philosophy always was.
Please.
That if you're a designer for the realms and you want your work to be accepted by the fans, and you don't want other designers to come along and overwrite it later, then you should also try, by whatever means necessary, to stay consistent with whatever lore has come before. Now, how well various designers do that is up to the reader's interpretation, but to my mind, if you start with the existing facts, you can always find something that will explain it.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Now, yeah. Ed, would you know anything else? Or
I'm sitting here thinking what I can reveal.
Wait a second.
Okay, pivot this way. There is one person who has, or had, because titles change, job titles, official job titles change, and that person was Chris Perkins, who had, I think he was right. Head of story. I think that was part of his title. But, you see, nobody works in isolation. There are designers, there are people such as Nathan Stewart, who work on the brand development, which means if somebody wants to license some part of the realms to do an external product, like a computer game, for instance, they will have asks that they want, like, where can we set this, and is it okay if we invent a queen or this or whatever, because we need it for our game. And then there'll be discussions, and Mike Murrells would be involved in those, and the designers underneath, and Jeremy Crawford as the rules guy. So exactly how and who would make a decision on a particular piece of lore, I haven't the faintest. I am not now, and never have been, either a TSR employee or a Wizards employee. So I can't tell you anything for certain, and I certainly can't tell you anything about the details of who decides a particular piece of lore. And people's job titles change constantly. But the person who had head of story or story manager or story director in his title fairly recently was Chris Perkins. Now, the complicating factor is that everybody, for instance, people from outside the company who want to license a product, will come to a Wizards employee, and I think it's Nathan Stewart, I think as the brand director, I think it's him, but I could be wrong, and say, okay, we'd like to do this, we need lore for this area, and if they receive approval for that, then I'm sure there's a discussion involving Mike Merrills and so on, and then there's designers, both on staff and freelancers who get called in. There's the head of D&D rules, who's Jeremy Crawford, and they would all discuss what is going to end up in, for instance, a Wizards product. But who makes the decision on a particular piece of lore is beyond me, and it may change depending on the situation. I'm sure that they have meetings about all these things, because in my visits to Wizards, there were tons and tons of meeting rooms, like the Bridge, the Grand Duchy, all sorts of, and you showed up for meetings and discussed things, like most collaborative creative companies.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, that's a whole lot of, I don't know.
Yeah. I mean, I'll say, you know, what just popped into my head was, you know, I can speak of 22 years ago.
Yeah.
When I was just starting up, just after I'd driven across country from Lake Geneva out to Renton, and I had to get going on the Lands of Intrigue. And I, to tell you how long ago this was, I actually had to send an email out to the Forgotten Realms listserv and ask everybody's help there to collect every bit of lore they could find about Tethir and Om and send it to me, or more specifically, send me anything that was a glitch or it wasn't so much an error or a mistype, but something that needed to be dealt with, codified, or cleaned up. So there were a number of things that had been contradicted since FR3, which was... Is that Empires of the...
Empire of the Sands.
Okay, that's right. And so between then and all the other stuff published since then, I knew I wouldn't get any time to write anything new if I had to go pour through all that lore and get it right. So at the time, I had the ability to just ask for help from the fans, and they came through marvelously, which is why there's a huge list of people I'm thanking in Lands of Intrigue. But that was how I used to do it. I don't know how they do it now. I'm assuming it's a much smaller cadre of people that are dealing with the realms and the story and so forth. So again, that's a question best put to Chris Perkins as to how it works now. But back then, it was, you know, I trusted that the fans who knew it more immediately than I did, so I got them to do that work of, okay, find me the errors that need to be cleaned up, and I will do that and then move forward. So that's why I'm still proudest of Lands of Intrigue among many things that I've worked on.
Yeah, Lands of Intrigue is incredible. It's and how did you get such a... Was that the one they got the huge page count?
No, the page count isn't any different than some of the other box sets at the time, but there's actually more stuff in Empires of the Shining Sands, the next box set, and I regret having done some of that. Because I can no longer, with my 52-year-old eyes, I can't read 8/9-point type. That was the only way we could pack everything in without having to cut 30% of it. And now,
Steven? Jeff, that's the part you don't know, is that the turnover version of Lands of Intrigue was about 30% longer.
Yeah, was it really?
Steven writes a lot, and it's very good.
If you ever want a thrill, find yourself a British wartime paperback. You can see through the pages, they're so thin, and most type isn't in it. I mean, the type is tiny, and there are almost no margins. because paper was so expensive and at such a premium. And I'm sure that if we'd had the choice back then, we would have written in the margins, we would have written sideways across each page after writing down it. Designers always want to put more stuff in.
Mm-hmm.
And back in those days, the approach that works today, if you have gorgeous art, please include it, wouldn't work back then because we couldn't afford gorgeous art except over right. a certain amount. And you had to storyboard anything you designed as a freelancer, and you mm-hmm. had to order quarter pages, half pages, or full pages, and you were discouraged from ever putting a full page in because, you know, that's a lot of space to waste on mirror art.
Yeah.
So
I think the only product I ever did full page art on was City of Splendors. Normally that was so frowned upon that I yeah. just learned to make do with other. But I'm glad I got Val Velusic to do those gorgeous full page pieces for each of the wards of Waterdeep at the time.
Mm, yeah, because for one thing, when a product is that long, your brain does need a boundary between sections and a visual rest.
Mm-hmm.
And as you use that product over and over again and come to love it, and you know, okay, there's something near the back on this, flip, 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 then those section illos, full-page illos, allow you to go, no, it's further back than this. You know, when you're doing it in a hurry at the gaming table, they're actually very useful for navigation. But at the time, if you're a freelance designer like me, it's like, why do we have to include art? I love art, but why do we have to include it? It's getting in the way of my beautiful works. More words!
Absolutely. So, Steven, I have a question for you, because I was one of those people that got to work on that Forgotten Realms cyclopedia you were putting together.
Back in the day. I'm just blown. I was one of three. I was doing that with Phil Athens and Julia Martin.
Right, but I got emails from you, so it was you.
Okay.
Okay, so whatever happened to that project, and what happened to all that, because I remember I spent many lunch breaks in my office sitting down and reading and writing into my little notebook, so I go home and type at my computer, you know, the little second, I did the Underdark.
Oh, you poor bastard.
I know. And then all of a sudden I get an email that says, oh, we decided not to continue with this. And that was...
Well, I, if it was up to me to make that decision, we would have done it. But, you know, I have my biases there. No, what we figured out is after we had done some of that initial research in figuring out... okay, sorry, I need to backpedal here for those who... haven't heard of this before. Back about 1998 yep. or 9, we were toying with the idea of trying to do a complete encyclopedic compilation of all the knowledge about the realms. And we started digging through all of the research, all of the published information, and I had between 8 and 12 different people doing the digging on exactly what was said where and certain things like that. But when Julia, Phil, and I sat down and we crunched some of the numbers of what we would need to do, that turned into, in order to do it right and as completely as we'd wanted to, that would have had to have been between 4 or 5 volumes of 240 to 320 pages each, and it would have taken at least 3 years to do it on a sane schedule with all three of us working on it in-house. And that's what determined that it was too expensive for Wizards to do, because they didn't want us to have 3 full-time staffers working on one product, even though it technically it was one product, even though it would be 5 different product releases or 6 or whatever it would end up being, because we were toying with the idea of here would be a volume just on characters, here's a volume on history, here's a volume on geography, and then all, I honestly can't remember what the others would be, but I knew that the history would be at least 1, if not 2, and the geography would most likely be 2.
Right.
And if anybody here can remember any more details, chime in. But
magic.
It really just came down to It would have been great to be able to do it, but it would be just too costly, and they couldn't see any way that they would ever recoup the investment, because you'd have to charge twice as much, if not more, per volume to see any sort of profit on it.
Yeah, that's a shame, because I think that would have been such an absolute incredible product. Now, were they going to do it as in paper, or were they going to do it like the Cyclopedia disc version of Dragon Magazine?
No, they would not repeat that problem, because that caused at least one, if not three, lawsuits. But
really,
no, they would never repeat the Cyclopedia on disc. It was planned to be a print product, because at the time, you know, online PDFs were a thing to be imagined about 4 or 5 years in the future.
Right. I mean, I can't imagine them doing it in a print product, because they're so strict on, you know, Waterdeep is only 64 pages long. or The North is only 64 pages long, that's all you get. I can't see them saying, yeah, you're going to have each volume is going to be 500 pages, you know.
Well, and that's what we told them is, you know, it would have to be, you know, 328 pages would be the minimum per volume. And they're like, no. Can't you do it in 128? I said, well, can we include magnifying glasses with every purchase?
Exactly. Now,
I mean, just the sheer amount of lore that got pulled together by you, Jeff, and Eric, and, Grant Christie, and George, and a number of folks that I'm blanking on right now. Sorry.
I'll have to chime in here. I was never part of the Realms Encyclopedia project.
Oh, you weren't? I thought you were part of the listserv and all that.
I was, but I was never part of the Realms Encyclopedia project.
Ah, okay.
Well, actually, nearly, because around that same time, Eric contacted me to have a chat about the Fallen Kingdom and was putting some information together in relation to that. I don't know whether that was for the Encyclopedia project or what it was for, but I remember we did all this work, and you were away on vacation, and so you came back to us having produced a whole bunch of stuff on the North and the Fallen Kingdom and Illithan and you name it. And then the individual who was assigned that area for the Realms Encyclopedia project wanted to have a read over what we'd come up with, and then disagreed profoundly with everything we'd written.
They were wrong. Well,
and so it was like, okay, yeah, fine. But yeah, I never got a gig for that. I probably too far away, I guess.
Well, the hardest part of that project for me was trying to decide what was important, because that's what they said, if I'm not mistaken. Find out, just get the important highlights on each piece, and, you know, and put that into the little grid that you put it on there. And each one of my grids wound up having like 3 pages in them, because I thought everything was important. So I thought maybe I was the one that caused them to shut it down, because they're like, God, this guy's just rewriting the product. That's all he's
yes,
doing.
Yes, Jeff, it was all your fault.
And everybody out there, my name is Jeff.
Hang your head in shame.
You can get me a Jeff Grubb on Facebook. It's okay.
That reminds me, Ed, did I ever send you the picture from, I think it was 2 Game Hole cons ago, we got Jeff out there for the convention, and Karen's husband managed to make him a nice big medallion that says Jeff Grubb number one.
Right. Oh, nice. No, I didn't see that. Send it.
I'll have to send it along.
and Stephen, my wife is still telling the story when we played Lords of Waterdeep. Ed was there for that. We're playing, and you leaned over to her, and you're like, Sharon, do you feel the need to win by more than 30 points? So good.
30 points is Sharon on a tame night.
Yeah.
I don't need to be ground into the dirt.
And the funny part is, she didn't know she had won. That was the good part.
She probably thought that was a game designer talking dirty to her.
Could be. I don't know. She does talk about you a lot now, Stephen, so I don't know.
Man at the time. I don't talk dirty to anybody but one person.
Aw, that's so nice anybody. Of you.
Don't tell anybody.
George is blushing now.
Okay, good night, everybody.
Thanks for coming. Tip your waitress. Hey, Curry, why don't you read that, if you scroll up a little bit. There's one there from Frank McCormick. It's got several parts to it, but we got to get back to it.
Okay. Yeah, no.
So, all right, Curry, you go ahead. Go ahead and read that question.
Okay, so Frank McCormick, he's got a whole series. I'll start with the first one. He would like to know names and deeds of Imiskari survivors, other than the ones like Hallister and the Deep Imiskari that have gotten a little coverage in the published lore. Any enclaves outside of Toril in the plains other and on other worlds?
Well, I would lay down some money that at least one of the tiers of Salune, if not multiple ones, would have a couple of people hiding out if they had any way of survival. And since Halaster can't be the only one, this is me leaving out some, you know, ellipses.
NDA.
This is a guess. I'm from a story perspective, sure, it makes more sense that, yes, more than one would have survived. Unless you want to play, I mean, unless we're saying, you know, Halaster is the last son of Imiskar, period. End of discussion. You know, he's the Superman of his lost culture.
Well, I think I put in a few.
Go ahead.
In the Zulkas of Thay piece that's now up on the DM's Guild, plug, for free. I mentioned a few Imiskari survivors in the same breath as Halaster. And the Archmage Thay, who obviously was the rebel leader against the Mulhorand back thousands of realms years ago. So I lumped Halaster, or then Hillifer, Thayd, and I mentioned two new ones just for fun. It's the golden Stephen Schend rule. Just drop names and places and items, sprinkle them liberally throughout the text, and hopefully someone has a play with them down the track.
Some people see them as, you know, debris. Some people see them as seeds. It doesn't matter, as long as they're there.
Awesome. Ed, you got anything to add to that?
No, I think that was very well put. You always, like, remember the old rule? For every loose end you tie off, introduce three more?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, that's right.
That's how the realm stays feeling alive.
Mm-hmm. And for everybody that ever complained that I wrote too much history in my products, I had to explain why the dungeons were there. That's why I wrote all that history. That's why I gave you every single battle that mattered, because it gave you the locations of graves to dig up if you wanted to do that sort of thing.
Oh, awesome. All right, Curry, go to the next one.
Okay. What sort of things would the lesser magic deities like Savarus and Belsharoon be up to post-Sundering Resurrection?
Bueller, Bueller, Bueller,
Bueller. Forgot okay. Gnome's crickets. There for you.
to elaborate, it says, particularly interested in what Apensor would be up to in the 1490s. He was only just starting to wake up before the spell plague and now has to start all over again.
Ah, well, I will show you. This is Stephen Chen's design brain at work. Godstone. Call Eric. It's all yours, boy.
Wait, boy, way to just toss it at Eric's feet. Wow.
And what's funny is I'm not really, really like a big fan of the gods either. I just, you know, there were lots of things to tie up that Ed kept throwing out and then, you know, throw some more out. But yep, default yep. Rule.
That's right. See earlier podcasts. Yeah,
exactly. But for Opensor, that's a deity that hasn't gotten a ton of play in the realms. And I actually can't remember off the top of my head where the first mention of him was. But he's essentially the god of psionics. And if I remember correctly, Mr. Schend did quite a lot of bit with psionics and the nation of Jomdath, which he then swamped under the tidal wave.
Well, I'll let you finish and then I'll correct. No, my only interjection there is I created Jomdath simply because we had Chondath references that were temporally incorrect when I was doing the Sea of Fallen Stars. And so we kind of shoehorned Jomdath in there, and someone else who came after me, so this would have been after 2000, they were the ones that made it into a psionic realm. I had little to nothing to do with that, I'm afraid.
So, be that as it may, that's how most good things come about. First, there's a timeline snafu, then you have to figure out an ancient empire to explain it.
Yeah.
And then somebody else comes along and gives a different twist on it, and all of a sudden, it feels like it's always been there. But, so, if Authensor is going to come back in any strong way, my guess is that what you will see is a series of cults arise. Cult is maybe the wrong word. Devotions, practices, secret societies, mind manipulators, who will spring up in various cities along the Vilhon Reach, in Vondath and Chondath, such as it is, or whatever else is there tomorrow. And they will start the spread of Alpenser's cult again. They'll probably be aided by some gem dragons who often use their psionic abilities to help them. And then they'll get smashed, almost definitely, because the wizards who practice the art, the Church of Maestra, the Church of Azuth, are not particularly interested in having the invisible art rival Maestra's glory. So they will try, but I imagine they will get smashed time and again. At least that would be my impression. Ed?
Over to you. I would fully agree. I would just point out that they are only now at Wizards of the Coast getting around to getting psionics ready for 5th edition. So anything we might say about that particular deity would not only be prudent not to say anything until the psionic stuff rolls out, it would also be, at least for me, under NDA because of the wording of the NDAs. The NDAs don't talk about additions. They talk about specific elements you can't talk about.
Mm-hmm.
So
Yeah. Well, I was just going to say, too, and I think George put it down, Ed Bonney is the one that created Alpenser for Lost Empires of Faerun. And I know over at Candlekeep, he said a few things. So if you go into Candlekeep forum and type in Alpenser or Ed Bonney, they should be able to find more information there. But he didn't write very much about the god in the official publication, so they talked about the church in his church in Reach of Tights in Jamdath cities of swords.
Jamdath.
Okay. Yeah, so yeah, there was very little was written. That's probably why he was looking for it, but maybe he can find some stuff that he needs over in Candlekeep. So
And to specifically answer the original question, most mortals living in the 1490s DR in the realms wouldn't know what the deities were up to in any detail. That's just not something that mortals on the ground, they only know what priests tell them. And priests only know what the deities tell them or their superiors tell them. And a lot of it is deliberately shrouded in mystery, as in by the churches. They don't want, in the same way that if you're a politician and you say something vague like, oh, we're going to move things forward and improve everyone's lot in society, that's pretty easy. But if you say, I will put up a stop sign on this corner and I will lower your taxes by 38 cents on the dollar, and you don't do it, then people can angrily call you on it. Well, clergy are the same way. They don't want to say specifics unless there's a good reason to do so, because some angry lay worshiper or somebody who venerates another deity before they venerate their deity will call them on it. So they tend not to say much of anything.
Right, and I liked Eric's answer back when we talked about this on, his first interview, and he said that any information about the gods is just beyond written history.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and we're not meant to know that stuff. So yeah, I agree. So any of it's supposition anyway. So I guess if you're putting these gods in your campaign, you could pretty much say anything you want about it.
Mm-hmm. Yes, and
you should say some contradictory things.
Right.
Yes. And the current realm state is at least 1492 DR. If you played Waterdeep Dragon Heist, that's in 1492 DR. I know some other things about dating that I can't say because it wasn't for public consumption. But the stuff that's been confirmed in public by Chris Perkins, as it happens for this one, is Waterdeep Dragon Heist is set in 1492 DR. And we haven't heard boo about Savrus, Velsharoon, or Alpenser up until then. So what would Alpenser be up to in the 1490s? We don't know up to at least 1492.
And I think it should stay that way, too.
Mm, yeah.
You know, the more intrigue there is and the less we know, I think the better. I think it makes for a more interesting game if you don't know. Oh, I know if I do this, my god's going to appear in front of me and hand me a dagger. You know,
mm-hmm.
You know. I like that. Matter of fact, I used your what you had said one time, Ed, about the gods showing favor or answering people's prayers. They don't just like, oh, hey, how you doing? Yeah, hi, it's AO over here. So what you want to do is go down here. They, you know, you pray to Lathander, you get a pink glow.
Yeah. A manifestation.
Right, exactly. Or you're for Helm, and you're walking through, and you're lost in the woods, and you find a gloved male laying in the dirt, arrested, but the fingers pointing in one direction. You know, something like that. So to me, that would be how the gods would act. They wouldn't just appear as a fiery bush and say, "Here's your commandments."
Yeah, and I can actually say one thing more. One of the design dictates handed to me when I was writing Death Masks, the novel, is when the gods all return after the Second Sundering is over, they are stepping back far more than they were in earlier years. Like, there won't be avatars of every deity walking around the realms, interfacing on a daily basis with mortals. They are stepping back. They are using fewer chosen or champions. They are, because every time they interfere directly in the world of mortals, it blows up in their face. It does not do well. So they try not to do it now. They've started to learn their lesson. And what that would mean is we would know less reliable lore about what deities are up to than in the past. And I'm saying that if the questioner, for instance, has a player character who is like a 14th or 16th level priest as a player character, that would still apply to him or her.
Right.
They would not be sure of what the deity's up to. All they know is what the deity chooses to tell them or send them dream visions of or hint at. And deities are great at hinting, because if you command somebody to do something and other people hear about it, they can block it or try and block that from happening.
Right.
Or, and some people will say, no, you want me to do that? No. But if you just sort of hint, you can move people to move mountains for you because of what they think you want without you actually saying it.
Right. That makes sense. Now, the next question on here, I'm pretty sure is going to be a big NDA whopper. And I'll say that, Curry, I'll go ahead and read it. It says, lore on any islands in the Shining Sea farther south than the maps generally show. So but he's talking down below Lantan?
Mm-hmm.
Any lore that you would have on anything down in that area? I guess down below the Wild Coast?
Not that I can share.
As I said. The big NDA hammer. I would love
of course.
It.
There is some small amount of lore that I have written up, but because I wrote it up and sent it in when I was being paid as a consultant, Wizards owns it. So I can't just sort of say, oh yeah, I'll get on Twitter, or I'll get on Facebook, or I'll get on here and share it. I can't, legally.
You know, I know of one small piece of lore that Ed did publish. I think it was Dragon 287, although I could have that wrong. He was doing an article about elven kingdoms that we didn't know much about.
Ah, yes.
And if I remember right, one of the kingdoms is a sea elf kingdom that surrounds the Shipgrave Isles, I think. I'd have to double check the issue, but I think that was what it was about. So there's at least one tiny bit.
Yes. Some stuff always creeps out.
That's off the coast of Helrua.
Okay, well, that will work. That's something at least. We got the answer something there. All right, Curry, go ahead and go to the next one there.
Okay. Opinions on how Mestika and Ankarom have been changed by the switch from Toril to Abir and now back to Toril again.
Those poor bastards. For some, they, you know, they may not have noticed. Who knows? I will confess I'm not as well read in terms of what happened with the realms throughout 4th edition. I was aware of what the info I was given in order to write Blackstaff Tower, but beyond that, I will confess that I haven't paid as close attention to what was going on west of the realms, and even though I did a lot of work with that because of Empires and Lands of Intrigue, but I'm not sure. I would guess it all depends on how much those folks paid attention to what was going on up above. I don't know how different Abir was in terms of, you know, how different it was from Toril. And what abutted the...
Less filling.
What's that?
Less filling, but tastes great.
Okay, well.
Ed, you can't add anything to that? Or
the white-bearded man shuffles wearily towards you, and when he stands squarely before you, in his palsied hand, he raises the battered war shield that says,
NDA. That's why I put it on there already.
Mm-hmm.
All right, Curry, move on. Okay, here we go. Who would be the most powerful but completely unknown to the realms, mage and Farron?
If we told you, then he wouldn't be completely unknown, would he? So there's never an answer to that question.
But
of course.
You're slick.
I hear there's this bearded sage in like this minor dale up near the Moon Sea who can like do a couple cantrips.
Okay, that's another one, Curry. We're not going to get answered.
Yeah.
I mean, the question would just summarily stop existing. So, yeah, of course.
Let me give you a hint. If we take the word most out of that sentence and say one of the powerful, most powerful mages, do you remember when Vanji and Mirmeen and some others hid out as in dragon shape in Cormyr?
Right.
Not all of those dragons were dragons. In fact, none of them were originally dragons. So some of them were other mages hiding out in dragon form.
Uh-huh.
One of them is really powerful.
Are they still in dragon form?
Some of them. Most of them, no, because that's the one thing that happened in the spell plague. You remember, Vanji came back as this weird, malformed, wizened little spider head. You know,
right,
like,
yeah.
Because things went bad with their... And presumably, some of those other guardians died. Some of those other guardians were permanently feeble-minded, insane. And some of those guardians were forced into other shapes and may have run and hidden. For good reason.
Ed, I know that the question was about the completely unknown mage,
yes.
But I've always been intrigued by two mages that you've referenced in your Shadows of Doom novel, in the Shadows of the Avatar series, the Charantia series and the Mulligrim series, because that was pretty fantastic. Yeah. And you mentioned two that you've never ever mentioned anywhere else. And Galister of Thay.
Yep.
And Murdrim the Hierarch Mage.
Yes.
And I've always been intrigued what a Hierarch Mage is.
Somebody who mastered the weave, made a separate piece or a separate side deal with Mystra, and was tutored by Mystra's servitors. So when in the D&D edition at the time, when they said, this is what an Archmage is, he's an Archmage of a different color. It's sort of like, if all of those archmages are spear-carrying guards, he's a general. Meaning he is a weave master and can call on the weave to power his spells. Meaning he can take any spell from a small cantrip to a meteor swarm and just grab weave power and feed it through the spell to upgun the spell. He doesn't usually do that because he's not interested in walking around the realms on leveling castles and mountain ranges. What he does instead is use that power to link spells together so that their spell effects combine, which usually means, for most of us, a horrible well magic surge. And you know, like, for instance, if two hostile mages cast spells at each other and their area effect spells and they both go off in the same area, who knows what'll happen? But it's going to be spectacular and it's going to be bad. And neither of the mages casting involved in that combination conflict are going to have the faintest inkling of what might happen unless they've been caught in one with that same combination before. But this is a guy who could do that deliberately, and perhaps for good, meaning he isn't a combat guy, does not want to be. What he wants to do instead is combine powerful spells that can't normally be combined with any great success, and combine them on the fly as opposed to casting one on top of the other.
Now, would that be anybody that we know has been written about?
No, except, as George said, that passing name reference.
Right.
And I can only imagine that, I suppose, that Galister of Thay is one of these famous red wizards who don't want to be the Zulkis, don't want to rule.
Bingo.
Some of them are actually more powerful than the existing Zulkirs.
Yep, and the Zulkirs, and for that matter, Zastam, are usually wise enough to just let these guys be, because they do three things. They anchor the realm itself, like they're sitting there in their towers, researching and working and so on. So if somebody did show up, and I don't mean a slow-moving invading army, I mean if somebody got summoned, some entity, something magically powerful, into the heart of Thay, they're there to be in their way and will defend, hey, those are my notes. I've worked on those for years. Don't you threaten them. Pow! You know. So there's that that they can serve as. And the other things are, they do the scut work of spell research, spell creativity, and, oh, we better cast that on everybody because this plague is making the rounds and we don't want to lose all our citizens. They do that sort of stuff so that the Zulkirs and so that Zastam and his buddies can do all the, I'm a big bad villain, let me go and do this. And let me meddle in the affairs of another realm far away. They can do all the fun stuff because these guys at home are doing the housekeeping, cooking the meals, cleaning the floor.
So they would they do all of their work through other people, and then would those people know that it's them doing it?
It depends on where you are. If you're up at the power level of the Zulkirs and the Tharchions and Zastam, you know exactly their usefulness and that they're doing that. If you're down working on the docks in Thay or trying to irrigate, you know nothing about these people. You don't never hear their names, and they never show up and bully anybody. They're not part of the rumors of, guess what, so-and-so blew up a city in Sembia. You know, because they don't have any public profile.
Okay, so, I mean, we may never know who they are, right? I mean,
that's
like,
right.
Not the power behind the throne, but power behind all of Faerun.
Yeah, and it's really useful because if somebody, some rules lawyer at your gaming table said, but there's nobody else who could have done it. It's got to be so-and-so, you say, that you know of. And smile.
I like that. I like that a lot.
There's the realms is like an onion. No matter how many layers you peel back, there's another layer. And then there's another layer.
I thought you were going to say there's a lot of crying.
Yeah, there's a lot of crying, yeah. But I mean, the wise people accept that they're never going to get to the bottom. They just try and make the most of it and live their lives.
Okay, no, that's great. That actually gives me something to think about because I never really thought about there being a higher power than the Chosen or these high-powered wizards like Vangie. And, you know, it just never occurred to me.
Okay, well, think of it this way. Mystra has Azuth, Savras, Velsharoon. Then they all have servitors. And Weave Ghosts is one sort of servitor. Entities, sentience, that have lost their bodies and live in the Weave. Okay? Those servitors. Remember when I published the Magister? Or wrote mm-hmm. the Magister? Excuse me.
Yes, sorry. Right.
Back in second edition. I kept mentioning servitors. I mean, there are all of these people who have lived their lives and then agreed to serve Mystra or been yanked out of certain death and destruction by Mystra and offered a choice. Like, you know, your body's being destroyed. Would you like to live on? Would you like to serve me? Would you like to finish those things which you wanted so much to do and never got around to? And if they say yes, then she's got another servitor. Those are all more powerful. And
are you saying these were demigods or high-powered wizards that when they ascended they took on another job?
Yeah, they took on another job. Okay. And they're smart and they're wise, and Mr. shares with them what knowledge they need. Some of them may have no power at all of their own, but they can call on the Weave. Sort of like sucking on the gas hose, you know, they can get what power they needed. So, for instance, if you say, oh, Zastam can blow anybody away, just to pick a name out of one of these servitors could show up and say, you won't do that. And Zastam says, ha ha ha, who are you? And hurl a spell, and it'll just bounce off the servitor or go into the servitor and be absorbed. And they'll say, are you finished?
You know? Oh, I like that.
And what that means is somebody like Zastam goes, you know, keeps like everybody that. Humble. Yeah,
Yeah, exactly. And then they answer to the god that they answered that, you know, above them.
Yeah.
Oh, that's a great, that'd be a great book.
Yeah, if only they put back the novel line. I have about 40 great books I just have to write.
Well, there's always a DM's Guild. We can make it a supplement. How's that?
Yeah, yeah.
That's 400 supplements.
Yeah.
Okay, let's go on to another question here, and this is by Dwayne. My parents were dragons, Tukerdurgan. And the first one out of three is: can you give us any insight into what the Dragon Empires, the Dawn Ages, look like? Anybody? And the other part of that first part of the question, part B, is what did a Dragon King stat like, which I don't think you have to give, and how vast were its followers in composition?
All right, well, I'll go to the fun. So here's my thought. So so you wanted to know about the time of dragons, right? Did I get that right?
Correct. Basically, the insight is what the dragon empires, the Dawn Ages, look like.
Okay. All right. So I've been thinking about this in the Savage North. You know, sometimes we call it the Savage Frontier, the collective area that includes the Sword, the Shield, the Sword Sea Coast, and the High Forest. So circa negative 30,000 DR, that's when the Time of Dragons was ushered in as the dragons swarmed together in the first flight of dragons. At that time, the rulers of Faerun were the Airy Empire, and the dragons assailed the avians in the air, on the land, and beneath the ground. And in the Savage North, the great kingdom of the Airy was Airy Saran, which is hidden amidst the Star Mounts, is what we would call them today. And the dragons shattered the capital city of Fawikri, I'm not sure I'm pronouncing that correctly, and reduced it to shattered ruins. So that happened circa 30,000, negative 30,000. And so my thought is, within a century, you basically have four dragon-ruled clan lands emerge in the Savage North. And they are Audjer Kespesk, Hesjing, which is a clan land of bronze dragons that basically rules what we would call the Sword Sea Coast, the Mare of Dead Men up to the Frozen Far, all the way out into the Trackless Sea, and actually extended under the waters as well. Then the next one you have is Kaysen Malsvir, a draconic word that means the Great Forest. And that was really the domain of the Green Dragons. And that would be one giant forest, everything that fell within the mountain ranges that we would call today the Great Peaks, the Sword Mountains, the Spine of the World, etc. Then you have Norlor Vertical, which is in the Spine of the World, and that was a silver dragon realm. And that more than the other realms, that one was really probably closest to what we would call a kingdom in the modern world. And that was dominated by Clan Silverwing, of which there is at least one representative still alive in the north today, who cohabits a floating rock with Valamon Darius, the dragon queen of the north, a gold dragon. And then last was Tural Hualnor, which is in the utter north around Lone Fang Mountain. And that was the white dragon. So you basically have these four clans that are sort of dominating, you know, sort of their natural areas. If you sort of look at the generic, where do these dragons live in the monster manual kind of thing. At the same time, you've got the colossal kingdom of Astoria reaching its height, and it's stretching across Faerun from the cold lands down to the Dohan Reach. And my suspicion is they probably went as far to the northwest as the Great Peaks. And so that's about negative 28,000. And, you know, this is not necessarily a pleasant place to live if you're one of those grubby half-caveman humans or if you're one of the Fey races. So in their efforts to undermine the dragon rule, the Fey races start opening portals to the world of Faerie. And through those portals come some of the primitive green elves that worship the fairy gods. And most of them remain in scattered tribes, although some of them do other things like the Illithari, the Avarial, and the Lothari. So then about negative 26,000, you start the Thousand-Year War, and an avatar of the draconic deity Garrix leads the red dragons in battle against the giants of Astoria. And eventually all the dragon kind is drawn into the conflict, So even though you have these great clan lands, you know, everybody is fighting against the giants for their own reasons. They're not necessarily fighting together, but they are fighting sort of in clans. And then by the time they're done, Astoria is shrunken down to a shadow of its former self, and the Colossal Kingdom occupies like the northernmost edge of the continent around the Great Glacier. So then what happens next? So now is when something really big happens that sort of upsets the clan lands in the north. There's an advanced great red worm known as Mahat Nartorian that flies north, and he's far more powerful than any of the great worms in the four clan lands. And he seizes the star mounts for himself, and this has a ripple effect that just transforms the north. The first thing that happens is he drives out many of the green dragons of the savage north. And so we'll have to investigate later what happens as they flow south and east into the rest of the realms. He also clashes repeatedly with the silver dragons of Norlorn Verthakal, which are up in the spine of the world, and the winged elves of Eri. But none of them are strong enough to dislodge the Master of Mountains, as he's called. And it's at this point that Durathil and Shaloria Moonflower arrive from Faerie via portal. And my thought is they probably end up in the Glade of Life, just south of the Starmounts. I think I have the name right for that. And that's sort of when the modern history that's revealed in Elaine's novel takes place. And so basically at that point in time, just as the elves are showing up, you have the green dragons in flight. The white dragons are still bottled up in the utter north by the silver dragons. The bronze dragons are doing their thing out on the trackless sea. But that silver dragon empire that's up in the spine of the world, it's going to fall, and it's going to fall hard. And once it does, that sort of unleashes the modern history of the north. At least that's my thought.
Oh, that's fantastic. Wow.
Wow.
Nice. Nice.
Imagine if you'd actually written that down.
No, I made all that up.
And actually, I think Dwayne's questions, Eric, are kind of more in your realm here. The next one is, do we have any information on the Udoxus used in Jamdath? He said they sound like Sonic Mithlers. Would that be about right?
Maybe.
Yeah, I think that might be it. It's probably something a little bit different. The Mithlar, I think they're probably more usable in the modern sense. The Mithlars, I think, are far more unbalanced and unstable, and are probably, much more dramatic effect differences, whereas those are actually something you might be able to control. Now, that said, there's probably versions of them that are equally unstable, but we don't have an empire of Psionicis that destructs to quite the extent that Netherald does, which suggests that maybe they haven't made quite the same mistakes.
Okay. All right. And then the last part of that is, what is the origin of the Eremykos? And I think we talked about this before.
Yeah, it's Canadian.
Canadian. Sorry, it's a giant restroom.
It's a good question. It's a good question. And, I mean, there's a design answer to it, but I'd rather give the realm's answer to it. You know, if you look at the north, right, it's clearly not nearly as forested as it once was. You know, Ilfarn basically stretched from Waterdeep up the Deseran over to the Neverwinter Woods. It was all one continuous forest. The high forest of Erivandar was just, you know, it was continuous. It just continued from the other bank of the Deseran and continued east. We've obviously lost vast swaths of forest in the north with all the various crown wars, troll hordes, orc hordes, dragons breathing fire here and there, you know, humans doing their thing, you know, vast chunks of it have been chopped down. What I think is interesting is that the high forest doesn't shrink. It really maintains its integrity. And so to me, my thought is that Eremykos is sort of has this symbiotic, that's the word I'm looking for, symbiotic relationship to the high forest. And as long as Eremykos is there, the high forest will probably maintain its current boundaries. And if anyone, and everyone keeps trying, managed to actually kill the whole thing off, we would probably see the collapse of the high forest within centuries.
Wasn't that the idea you got from when you read about that, the world's largest fungus underneath candles.
Yeah, I was trying not to repeat myself, but yes.
No, that's no. Okay. No, yeah, we talked about it in an earlier podcast, but I want to just give a little background to it.
That's where that came from was, you know, it's the largest living organism. I also, from a design perspective, noticed that we literally hadn't put anything under the high forest, nor did we have any, at least at the time I was designing it, any significant interlopers into the high forest from the Underdark. And so I was trying to figure out, well, what kind of barrier is there to prevent the drow from coming up and just fighting endlessly with the elves of Irlan and Sharvan and Sluvani? And what I came up with was this giant fungus that ebbs and flows. It gives the DM the ability to create passages and wall them off whenever they want to. And so it also allows you to unveil, you know, hidden cities, lost dungeons, whenever it strikes you. And so it kind of gives you that in-game excuse to make things come and go.
No, right, absolutely.
And that's certainly more interesting than just saying there's a lot of granite and bedrock underneath the high forest.
That's true.
Basically, what happens is if you jump up and down in the high forest, it bounces. It's like a big trampoline.
It's fun. A big fungus.
A bouncing castle.
Kind of like Canada.
Exactly.
Okay. I find it funny. I'm sorry. Oh, that's great. That's great. Okay. This next one actually could be for everybody. From Jordan Maywood, talking about the plains, and, you know, the different planes. Which do you think deserves more recognition and might be an interesting choice for a campaign?
Hell. So
hell. There you go.
Hell.
Well, actually, that's the one that has been most detailed.
Right.
Not just by me, but by standalone published official products. Chris Pramus did one, you know, as the editions of Unwound. And the other thing is, it depends on which cosmology you're using, because some of those planes have changed their nature. Great untold tales of D&D and the realms. Years and years ago, after we did the Hells in Dragon Magazine, there was a gamer out in Vancouver, I think, named Stephen Innes, who created some things for the game. He was published in Dragon. He created a monster that became an official one, the Lilend. And he and I corresponded for almost a year and built Limbo with the Slad Empires and detailed it all and did it all up and sent it into Dragon. And I believe Jim Ward killed it. I think because it would have taken about 80 pages of Dragon magazine. Now, to me, that's a perfect excuse for a serialized column, but obviously not in the thinking of the time. So that was all done up and never published.
So I can tell you my favorite is the Hells, and obviously WotC has recently done Descent into Avernus, which is a great plot line. I actually wrote the thing I had thought of before that, but never really shared it with anyone but George. I always wanted to go back to the old gray box where, if you remember, around Dragonspear Castle, there were this green mist flowing over the lands as devils led armies of goblins and orcs and bugbears against the cities of the Sword Coast. And, you know, the Time of Troubles storyline kind of kept us from really digging into that, but I always loved that storyline. Combine that with Ed's articles on the Nine Hells and the early issues of Dragon, you really have some interesting things there. So the storyline I always played with was coming back to those green mists again, which I always envisioned as one of Tiamat's consorts, who was a green dragon. I think I named him Berinder. He had, in his dying days, had breathed out over part of the Nine Hells, I call it the Bloodmoors, and had this green mist flowing out through the Bloodmoors. And, you know, basically when you opened a portal, that green mist, which was kind of caustic, came through the portal and spread out over the Western realms. And so I always wanted to play with that. So I ended up writing an adventure, which I never published. It's actually done other than one map. I should finish the map someday. But it basically takes high-level adventurers. They go back to Dragonspear Castle. They find out that a certain tiefling has opened a planar breach. That's more than just like a portal. That's like a miles long, 100 mile long breach between the two planes with the intent of absorbing the Sword Coast into the Nine Hells. And the players have the opportunity to go in through the breach, fight some devils, and they find this really cool dungeon amidst the Bloodmoors. And they have the opportunity to close the portal that's never end, that keeps reopening under Dragonspear Castle. So for me, rather than having, I mean, Planescape was a great setting, don't get me wrong, rather than having an adventure in Planescape, I like to think of it as a brief sojourn from the realms where you're in and out and you try to undo some deadly problem that's impacting the realms, close a portal, retrieve an artifact, whatever it might be. So anyhow, someday I'll release that Dragonspear portal adventure. That was my favorite.
I agree with that, because one of the things I think that if you are going to be traveling the planes or hopping in the planes is you shouldn't spend much time there.
Yeah.
You know, it has to be like a covert mission. You're in and out as little time as possible, or else you're going to have some really big ramifications because of that. But I like that idea.
Yeah. So the thing that I did was I used Ed had written these great devil outcasts of the first level, which I always thought were much better than working with some of the entrenched hierarchy of the Hells, was working with these outcasts. You could actually imagine they wouldn't kill you instantly, but might need something from you. And so I think I played with like Armaros, who had the great name, the Resolver of Enchantments, and a couple others as well. Sort of weave them into a storyline. So I always thought it was great fun to take some of those outcast devils and weave them into a storyline. That was my favorite.
Yeah, the nice thing about outcast devils is they can't summon the hordes of hell the moment you're there. So your party has a slim hope of getting out again alive.
No, absolutely.
I actually had a discussion with someone on one of the Forgotten Realms Facebook pages the other day who was asking about places to go and see in Avernus, the first layer of hell. And I said, I don't think it's a holiday destination. And I commended him to your novel Elminster in Hell, Ed, and said, that's what happens when you decide to take a wander around Avernus.
Yep.
Unless you're super powerful yourself, and even then that's unlikely to get you very far. The only way you can just literally walk around Avernus is if you're carrying some sort of token, or it's well known that you're under the protection of an archdevil or some other powerful fiend, and so people won't touch you simply for that reason. Otherwise, it's open season and you're fair game.
Yep, your dinner.
Your dinner, I like that. You know what I'd like to see? I love the idea of Limbo. I'd love to see more on Limbo, like Eric they said earlier. I'd like to see some more about Sigil, about how you get to these other planes and other places on Planescape. I think that it'd be great if we had an updated version of that.
So there's another way to get there, too. There was an article I did a while back that built off a first edition product, the World Serpent Inn.
The World Serpent Inn.
Yeah, that comes from OP1, Tales of the Outer Planes.
Yep.
And I think I wrote it up for maybe Dragon 350, I can't remember off the top of my head. But it's basically a tavern that can open up into any city that you're in and allows you to interact with some folks and to very quickly transition elsewhere, be it Sigil or elsewhere in the plains, if you really want to go back.
Anybody else?
I've got nothing.
You got nothing?
Sorry.
No worries. Okay, I got another question, a couple of questions from Voren. First, he says he loves our podcast. Yay, we love it. And this is a question about the Wizards 3. So this may be more for Ed. Where did the idea of the Wizards 3 come from?
It was an editorial assignment from Dragon. Remember, I was an unpaid member of Dragon's staff at that point, a creative editor later, contributing editor later, creative editor. And I was asked, and that was Kim Mohan came from the world of journalism into the world of gaming. And he was so delighted to have somebody that he could say, hey, could you write me this many words or this many pages worth on this topic by Friday? You know, journalism stuff. And I could do it. So then he could fill in the little gaps to balance an issue. Because secret of the day, in those days, magazines and everything else were printed in signatures. And if you got more ads, you suddenly had to have more copy to go in between them to fill out the signature. So that's one of the reasons I was doing stuff. And he said, okay, we'd like a vehicle that we could publicize all of the TSR worlds and not have them compete against each other as rivals, but to sort of cross-pollinate. So gamers who were only familiar with one would get a little taste of the others and maybe like it and maybe start buying it as well. So I was actually assigned the Wizards 3 King, and I think the title, the Wizards 3, I came up with, but I think I was assigned, could you write one of these? And of course I used it as an excuse to shoehorn more new monsters, magic items, and spells into, which was received with enthusiasm at the offices of Dragon, because great, they'll lap it up, because everybody can plunder those things, whether they care about your articles or not, they can plunder them for their game. So that's where the idea came from. I was assigned it. Raistlin was supposed to be part of the group, but Margaret and Tracy were just writing a novel, or had already written a novel, and Books and Games didn't always know what was going on, and the Dragon staff were sort of out to one side of games, and were sometimes even further out of the loop. And what happened is, as I was writing the early ones, Raistlin disappeared in the Dragonlance fiction, which is why in the end we had Dalimar as a fill-in, because there had to be somebody to represent Kryn. And I would say, so what happened to Raistlin? Oh, we can't tell you. And I said, because I'm not on staff? And they said, because we don't know yet. Until Margaret and Tracy write it in the next book. Oh, okay. But I was still supposed to have a representative of Kryn. So that's... Raistlin was part of the group, except he wasn't. He never showed. There were discussions. So yeah, the part three, were there ever any plans to increase the group to four or five with the addition of a mage from Mystera or Eberron, perhaps an Elphaian Archmage? Okay, Eberron was not in the picture yet. That was years in the future. So there were some discussions with Bruce Hurd, who was acquisitions manager. So he dealt with all freelancers like me. And he was also helming the known world, which became Mystara. It was sort of his pet project at the time. So we talked about, do we put a representative in from the known world? And the idea in house was, it's probably a good idea eventually, but not right now, because the way the known world was coming out was one D&D regional product after another. So you were getting to know the known world, starting with the Grand Duchy of Karamekos, and then going all over the map, one product at a time. And each designer of each product was making their own bit have a different flavor than the other kingdoms around it. And because it was an ever-changing bucking bronco, it was like, well, let's not jump into that boat yet. Because if you write something, Ed, and this guy from Mystara is giving them new spells and magic items, and they don't fit with what shows up in the later products, that's going to be problematic. Like, we're building in canon contradictions. So we can avoid those canon contradictions by just staying with the Wizards 3, which allows us to keep the name, and then we just bring back the Wizards 3 every time there's an anniversary issue of Dragon, and people will want to hang out again with, you know, and watch them eat all my ice cream and drink all my amaretto and all that fun stuff. So there you go. There's the answer to all those things. I could finally answer something without NDAs going, womp. Yeah. You see, you depict the NDA as a shield. I think of it as that giant Monty Python foot.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
And I just get going on an answer, and the foot comes down and goes, and it ends right there, you know. Anyway, so there you go. Answers. Ta-da! We have answers. We have tons of answers. We can make up answers.
That's pretty good. No, that was really good. Curry, you want to read this next one here?
Okay, let's see. This is from Arius. What is a typical burial mound arrangement for the elves of Carmanthar?
Wow. Okay, if you read The Herald, the novel that I wrote that finishes the Sundering Saga, you will see a lot of burial crypts guarded by Balenorn underneath Carmanthar. They're, picture a long subterranean corridor. Sort of like a high school. I'm trying to remember what high schools look like in Luxembourg. I was only there very briefly. I was much younger. A North American high school tends to be long, straight corridors with doors lining it on both sides, which lead into classrooms. And picture that underneath the City of Song, with Balenorn guarding each door. That's how most of the elves, in that city at least, were buried. So I don't think they had burial mounds, per se. But out in the deep wild forest, it's far more likely that the burials were individual body cavities dug out against the roots of particular trees, and then the tree would absorb the nutrients of the body over time, so that the elf would feed a tree, become part of the cycle of life again. So there cool. we are. Yeah.
I like that.
I think Stephen actually dealt with this himself in the Cormanthyr accessory. He had a section on elven death, and he talked about how burial practices, especially in the context of the Veil of Lost Voices in Cormanthyr.
And I think did? Wow.
Yeah, you did. He said, gold elves bury their dead in honored tombs. Green elves bury their dead in secret, and the moon elves opt to do either method, depending on the wishes and status of the deceased. There you go. And there's even more in the Tangled Veil chapter, allegedly. That's what I loved about you, Stephen. You never missed a thing.
Oh, wow. Yeah, bear in mind that, yeah, I wrote Cormanthyr, what, 24 years ago?
Something like that.
Yeah, I have to admit, a lot of it, if I'm remembering it correctly, some of the differentiation I put in there for among the elves and the subtypes and how they would do their own burial customs, I will admit I shamelessly stole from one issue of Sandman, where we were dealing with the necropolis of Litharge, and they were wandering through all those different methods of how to inter a corpse, whether by air burial, earth burial, fire, etc., etc. So part of that was just a tip of the hat in that direction, but I will confess I never put a huge amount of thought into how to lay out an elven crypt. So sorry,
I can tell you, Stephen, that the one dragon article that you never wrote, that I always wanted you to write, you wrote an amazing dragon article on dwarven tombs.
Uh-huh, and I turned it into the Lost Level eventually, I think.
some of it did, yeah, but you had like a whole dragon article, and I can't remember the issue anymore, George might, but it really like went into exhaustive detail of what you would find in a dwarven tomb, and I had always wished that you and Ed together could have written that article for the elves as well. That would have been perfect. So
it would have been fun.
The unwritten dragon article that I always wanted. I'm sure there are others, but that's always the one that stuck in my head.
Well, thanks. There we go. Dragon 224.
There you go. That's it.
And I remember the title, but I'm desperately trying to remember anything more about it. Other than some vague stuff about the architecture and, I'm going to have to go dig that up now. Can you have me back again once I've refreshed my brain on all this, Jeff?
Anytime, Stephen. You're always welcome.
Oh, okay.
Curry, you want to take that next question?
Okay, the next one I'm actually going to skip over. We've covered this one before about different dialogues and dialects and how they're interpreted from place to place, and I think the general consensus is whatever you want it to be. That seemed to be the answer that went around the table, unless you guys want to put a different spin on phrases and such and how they could be interpreted in the realms. But I think we probably talked that one to exhaustion before.
We never got into phrases. We did dialects, local dialects. We did regional dialects. But we never talked about certain phrases like he's asking here. To light up like a Christmas tree. I think it's more of a modern one, but are there any realms equivalent to something like these?
I can answer the first two phrases. The realm's way of saying that something lit up like a Christmas tree is, it caught starfire right in front of me. At least amongst humans using common tongue, who have ever had anything to do with a traveling merchant anywhere, because they carry the slang expressions in the common tongue around the realms, so that a person using slang in Om will very quickly be understood in the cities of Sembia because a merchant's traveling around. So to be lit up like a Christmas tree, or to light up like a Christmas tree, is it caught starfire right in front of me. And Ulcinella's secret, the way of saying that in the realms, is known but to the gods, and therefore to us all.
Okay, I like those.
Yeah, and no offense to Vanger de Hast and all the rest, but part of me would want to almost, maybe the Sembians would refer to it as a Cormirian secret, you know?
Yes, yes.
Everybody knows about it, but they think it's a secret, wink, wink. So it's, you know, it's one of those things of wherever you're at in the realms, if they have a cultural or political enemy, they're going to use that more or less as a minor snide insult sort of thing.
I have an answer for the third one, too.
Oh, you do? Oh, great.
Yeah, searching Mary around Rome is searching for my aunt's old stocking.
Say that again?
Searching for my auntie's old stocking.
Oh, auntie's old stocking.
Yeah.
And what does it mean, the same thing, what he's talking about?
Yeah, yeah.
Okay.
You've been sent an impossible task, and which, of course, is very familiar to Canadians when we go to the United States, because you're from Canada. You'll know my friend Sid. and you sort of go, Canada's bigger than the United States. Doesn't have as many people, but it's bigger. Why would I know Sid? Well, he's in Vancouver. Yeah, Vancouver, 600 miles away from me. You know?
Of course. Yeah. I thought Canadians had telepathy.
Yeah, yeah. Well, mm-hmm.
That's only if they're wearing the proper toques.
That's right. That is too good. Well, we have some here from the Woolly Rupert. From over in...
Giant Space Hamster.
That's right. That's right. He said he's been pondering the gasness of Cormyr recently, particularly the fact that while all are considered to have betrayed Cormyr, some of those betrayals are far worse than others, and some are so minor it begs the question of why another betrayal wasn't selected.
Yeah, you'll have to ask Troy about that.
Yeah. I grappled with the gasness in a very, very... concerted fashion in my article at the DM's Guild, which the questioner was already aware of. It was extremely difficult to understand the genesis of the Gasneth, why particular ones were chosen and how they came to be over a significant spread of Cormyr's history. I did the best I could in terms of trying to provide an explanation. In terms of, I think the questioner asked why Suzara Oberskier was part of the Gasness because she didn't betray the kingdom of Cormyr. That wasn't actually the reason why Gasness became the Gasness. It wasn't betraying Cormyr, it was betraying the Oberskiers. A subtle but actual difference. Because the Oberskier bloodline was the one selected by the elves to take rulership of the Forest Kingdom, and quite simply, the Oberskiers are tied into the Forest Kingdom in ways that are simply more than just having the title. So Suzara became a Gasneth because she betrayed the Oberskiers, not because she betrayed Cormyr the land. But in terms of why some were chosen to be Gasneths and some weren't, it's a very, very interesting question, and one, only Troy Denning can explain to you why that's the case. I know why from a fiction point of view he chose those individuals, because they'd already featured in material on the realm. There isn't a huge amount of rhyme or reason to those choices, I would agree.
I had a brief discussion with James Wyatt about this at a Gen Con some years back. And he was, you know, he went to Oberlin and was ordained as a minister. And his take on it, which I agree with, is that it also has to do with the nature of the individual person. Some of them are, quote, susceptible, as in their Gasneth material, and others, for various reasons, are not. And if we don't know what the inner workings of a person are, we can't know from the outside who's going to be chosen beforehand. It might have to do with sanity, it might have to do with moral fiber, it might have to do with determination, like can you be swayed from your principles and goals? As Ellen Kushner, the author, used to say, I have morals, I just don't have scruples. You know, so that may be why one person and their transgression makes them a Gasneth, and another person and their transgression does not.
Now, is this other than the seven fallen demons that are Gasneths?
Yeah, I mean, individuals in Cormyr, named individuals, humans born and raised in Cormyr, who turned into Gasneths. And I mean,
okay.
The original question that was posed to us, I totally agree that Rowan, his crime, if it is that, is so markedly different in scale and severity from some of the others, it's like, what? You know? So I think some sort of factor like that has to be in it. And
right.
I think a hunger or love for the land, Cormyr, perhaps out of the desire to come to rule it or to get a big piece of it or to own this particular part of it, might be part of it, part of becoming a Ghazneth, whereas somebody who doesn't care.
Right. You know, I'm kind of skipping down his question because you've already kind of hitting on these a little bit. It says, Rowan Cormero didn't follow orders, but as I recall, he was still acting to protect the Barsker family, which included his wife, and became a Ghazneth for it. He said to this was very questionable to him.
Mm-hmm. And it is very questionable because we can't understand why some people become Ghazneths and others don't. And again, that's why I have to say I have to buy James Wyatt's idea that it also has to do with the nature of the person. What can the magic affect to turn them into a Ghazneth? Whereas, say, the person next to them, no.
Okay, and I have to say, I don't know. How do they become a Ghazneth? What is the magic or what happens to cause that?
We don't know.
It's not an NDA. You just don't know.
No, it's never been specified. Well, okay.
I think that falls under the Ask Troy Denning.
Yeah, exactly. And Troy has written a thing on that, but it didn't cover the how are they chosen and how do they become, because I think there were plans for further fiction. And of course, if you specify something, you tie your own hands in what you can do. So I think that's why that the answer to that was a skating around it rather than answering it.
One other thought that I had, and I might be misremembering the story, so this couldn't quite work. I like the explanations that have been given so far. The only one that I ever wondered about was sometimes if you want to undermine an evil plot and do it very, very subtly, working in someone who marginally qualifies and isn't like over the top qualified can have the effect of weakening an attack form. So at a high level, my thought was one way some secret power could undermine a plot, and this would be more along the lines of a Kelvin probably than, you know, some of your more goody-two-shoe types. But if you insert a marginal candidate for a villainous spot in a ritual, you might have the effect of undermining said ritual. Yes, some evil will be done, but it won't be as bad as it could be. So I always wondered if perhaps what had happened there is that someone had sort of put in perhaps the least qualified candidate, if as it were, in a way to undermine the plot, just as a thought.
Yeah, and I'd have another thought on that. A character, I think, would be more susceptible to being a Ghazneth and more useful to the intent behind the magic of becoming a Ghazneth once they become a Ghazneth if they are malleable, if they are apt to change their character. So if you're dealing with somebody like, say, Lady Macbeth, who's not going to change her essential nature, then she would make a bad Ghazneth even though she's evil and determined, because she can't change enough. If you go to Shakespeare's Hamlet, Hamlet might make a good Ghazneth because he's changing throughout the play. The people who are out and out villains and don't change wouldn't make good Ghazneths. They're sort of like, they may be villains, they may be terrible, but they're not going to change. They're not going to grow. They're not going to be flexible, and therefore not make good Ghazneths. I mean, arguably, Rowan Cormyr changes markedly throughout the tale in which he becomes a Ghazneth.
Right. And,
right.
And also, he talks about Suzara Obarsker, who's the first Ghazneth.
Yep.
Why did she become a Ghazneth?
Ask Troy. No.
Ask Troy Denning. Okay.
No, remember, it's not, as George quite rightly pointed out, it's not betraying a kingdom. It's betraying the Obarskers. Now, you know, again, I agree. Questionable, because was she being a villain? Was she doing it to be vindictive and break up the family? No. She was doing it because she just wasn't cut out for that life.
Right.
So,
right.
Yeah, again, that's a one of those, you know.
A questionable one right there. Yeah. Okay, so Muir asks another question here for anyone who wants to weigh in on it. because he said he can't find a reference. What is the state of dental hygiene in various parts of the realms? I don't know.
Awful.
Where's that
we
sound effect?
We covered this. We covered this.
Did we cover this?
years and years. Well, okay, not on the podcast. We've covered this in Realms Lore. There are wooden dentures available in large cities everywhere, and merchants can take them to places. And these are the wooden dentures where it's a carved upper and a carved lower, which you slip into your mouth, and it has a hinge. And you have to reach in there and adjust the hinge, or you're never getting your mouth shut again. Or you're never getting your teeth open again.
Right.
They're made of wood, so you can go somewhere private and put them in a clamp and take a chisel and a hammer and remove thickness of the jaws and remove teeth. The wooden fake teeth, as you wish, to sort of fit with what you've got. So in effect, it's a partial plate. Unlike the modern first world idea that all medieval people were stinking heaps of awful who never bathed and never, you know, that's not true. What happened in our real world in history is they didn't understand what sugar did to teeth. So that if you were wealthy up the top, you usually had blackened stumps of teeth because you ate too much sugar and it rotted your teeth. If you were at the bottom, the peasants, if you happened to bite down on a bone or whatever, you could chip or break a tooth or have it knocked out in a brawl or in a farming accident or whatever. And the same sort of things apply in the realms. But between the herbs that give you fresh breath and the making your own sassafras toothbrush, which I don't know if Boy Scouts are taught this these days, because they tend to be not want Boy Scouts to walk around the wilderness cutting branches off things and catching and killing wildlife and eating it and digging trenches around their tents and all the destructive stuff that they were taught to do as a matter of course when the Boy Scouts began. But there's this way of taking the right twigs and peeling the bark off the twigs back in, half peeling it in ribbons and using that as a toothbrush. And there are other things you can use, cuttlefish bone and so on, in the same way that if you have a budgie, it has a cuttlefish bone stuck in the side of the cage and all of that. And the same things apply in the realms. Because I was asked this years and years ago at a Milwaukee-era Gen Con, and I just blithely said, well, you know, if you eat the right small jellyfish off the Sword Coast, you pop them in your mouth and they clean your teeth completely. And everybody went, huh? And I said, well, when you're creating your own world, you can just make up stuff like that.
Right.
And people looked at me like, that's cheating. And it was like, you
how
guys
is that
don't
cheating?
Understand. You realize, of course, if we made up all of this, it's all fictitious.
Mm-hmm. Well, and, you know, I mean, that jellyfish idea, they stole it completely with Farscape. They had these little alien things that you pop in your mouth, they eat all the plaque off your teeth, and then you put them back in their little jar. I mean, there's no reason that, you know, okay, for somebody that lives off the coast, they can't get those jellyfish. Fine, there's this little thing that's a relative of a shrew that does the same thing in woodlands and grasslands and all that stuff. So, you know, if you need to explain it, there you go.
No, yeah. It's perfect. There's also a second part of that question here, kind of the second part. He said it resulted from a discussion on what a cure disease spell would have on halitosis.
Oh, okay. So what the cure disease... Halitosis is caused by bacteria.
Right, so it wouldn't be a cure disease.
It depends. If the bacteria is the sort that could be beneficial to the body when living in it, like, as in, we all are able to digest stuff by it because we have the right bacteria in our gut. If it's able to live in the body in a fairly stable, comfortable relationship without making the body sick, then the cure disease is not going to have any effect on it because the spell does not see it as something that shouldn't be in the body.
Right.
If the halitosis is caused by a violent virus that you've just picked up, yeah, it's going to wipe out the virus and wipe out the bacteria with it. And as long as you get some moisture into your mouth, the halitosis is going to go away right away after the spell has affected it. So therefore, the spell would take care of it. But you see, this is an effortless example of a dungeon master rationalizing whatever he wants, whatever result he or she wants. Your Dungeon Master can probably do this too. Which is why Dungeon Master should come with warning labels. Warning, apt to do just about anything. Do not piss Dungeon Master off.
Oh yeah, oh yeah. I've used that rule many times. I think Curry can attest to that.
It's my world and welcome to it. That's how we start.
That's right.
The most dangerous phrase from a DM is, are you sure you want to do that?
And I've said that before where I stopped the action, leaned over the screen and looked him in the eye and said that, are you sure that's what you want to do?
And one of my players would always respond. She'd look at the ceiling, sigh, and she'd say, assume the position.
Oh, that's good. That's really good. Oh, my God. Okay, I have another one here from Gary Dallas. These are all from Candlekeep. They had some great questions. He's still interested to know about the dragon Urlinthargar. I can't even, won't even try. I'm not gonna put Curry through that. It's Ulinthargar. Ulinthargar.
Thank you.
Yes, the man who invented it. Okay. Which plagued the folk in ages past. I guess there's not enough written about this dragon.
Aw.
Which dragon is this again?
I can't even say it again. Ed, go ahead.
Saga. It's a one-off mentioned in one of Ed's Worms of the North articles, but I'm just trying to work out which one it was. I can't recall.
Ulinthargar. Here it is. Ulinthargar.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Not a sec. I got it. It's a dead male red worm. I actually have these articles up for another idea I have going.
Which dragon was it?
It's, hang on a second. Sorry. I had to find the Excel spreadsheet. So this is Ulinthargar the Devouring Flame from Dragon 240.
Volunteer the Glory Tongue.
Oh, yeah, that one. And you can edit all this part out, right?
I wouldn't dare. I should do that to a tune for a Christmas carol.
Almost there. Okay. There we go. Yes. Oh, this is the whole story of Jerakin's Tower. So Volunteer found about 60 summers ago on the skeleton of a drowned dragon that was just off the end of Highport, the end of the island of Highport in the Moonshades, which, if I remember correctly, is the Corinne Archipelago. And the skeleton might have been the remains of the red dragon known as Ulinthargar the Devouring Flame, of whom the folk tell wild tales.
Yep.
That's all we know, Ed, unless you want to share a little bit more.
Well, no, all I will say is the wild tales, that's one of those things where mothers and grandmothers use it to scare their children down the generations. So most of these wild tales really are wild, as in made up, or cribbed from the doings of another dragon, and then augmented over many retellings. So something that started as a red dragon hiccuped and burned half a village, turned into a red dragon scoured an entire kingdom, and then when they rebuild it, did it again. You know, so there's lots of exaggeration. But beyond that, there's nothing I can tell you.
Okay, well, I think you've done pretty good, though.
Was that the skeleton of Ulinthargar, or was it a different dragon?
It was a different dragon. We do not know the fate of Ulinthargar.
Aha.
Oh.
May still be alive, because some of these dragons dabbled in magic. Yeah.
No, you don't say.
Have you know every dragon I've ever spoken to never dabbles. Their claws are too sharp for that, you know.
It might injure something. Okay, so
we do know one more thing, which is Ulinthargar is believed to live in the or have lived ere his death in the Giant Spine range of the Moonshades, and we know that from Dragons of Faerun, page 157.
And who put that there?
I have no idea.
And I was wondering wondering about the Worms of the North article series, which was extensive and brilliant. Was that your idea to do that article column in Dragon, or did they come to you about that one?
No, that was my idea. What was happening over the years is they would ask me, hey, could you, Mr. Creative Editor, could you, like, we need this many pages filled. And then I'd do something, a series, and they'd say, yeah, could you switch gears and do something else? So I'd say, okay, how about this? Because by then there was email, so we could toss it back and forth, meaning somebody could print it out and take it around to various cubicles or to a design meeting and say, what do you think? And then they'd come back and say, why don't you just do one of them and send it to us, and we'll see if we like it. I'd say, okay. So I'd do one of them and send it. They'd say, yeah, we like it. I'd say, okay. And I think in the case of Worms of the North, I think they had no idea how long this was going to run. And I very quickly decided, okay, I'm going to spin this out. Because it's my way of cramming Realms lore about people, places, and things. Remember the dragon that hid in portraits and in Waterdeep? It was my way of talking about all sorts of other lore. And so I just kept going for as long as they'd let me.
That's good.
Oh, wait a minute. I did
on the Worms of the North too, Ed, if you don't mind a second question.
Yeah.
So, and this was probably something I would have thought would have been different. And so that's why I'm so interested why you did it the way you did it. So I would have expected the territories of the dragons to have been smaller and not overlap. And I think that was always the thing that surprised me in the Worms of the North columns. And I was hoping you could maybe say what your thinking was in terms of making the territory so big and so overlapping.
Yeah, I had to overlapping for two reasons. I was told we want opportunities for mid-air dragon combat. You might remember one of the Dungeon Master screens years ago had a lovely illustration of two dragons in mid-air wrapped around each other. So that's the overlap bit, or one part of the overlap bit. The other part of the overlap bit is, where the heck did half these dragons get enough raw food to keep themselves going? I mean, I know they cut down on the amount of food they need for sleeping for centuries, so they're not burning their body mass to power what they're doing. But still, you need a huge amount of land surface, particularly if it doesn't have large herds of livestock helpfully sitting out in the open all over it for the dragon to just swoop down and take. Now, part of that was taken care of by the fact that as each edition of the game came along, they said a little bit more about what this dragon type or what that dragon type ate. And some of them were, you know, not eating raw red meat all the time. So that was helpful in some ways. But I still had to figure out how, in this known terrain of the Savage Coast, the Sword Coast North, they would get enough space to hunt, to feed themselves, so they didn't fall out of the sky enfeebled and just lie there and die because there's not enough food for them to. They're so weak they can't lift a talon, you know. So that's how come they ended up with overlaps. And the other thing is, it was clear to me that there would be strategic areas that lots of dragons would want to claim, and some of them would fight to the death whenever they met, and others would just strategically avoid each other. Oh, well, if he's flying today hunting, I'll just hide out for the day. And the moment he goes back to his lair, it's my turn to hunt. You know, that sort of thing. So that's why they ended up all overlapping.
Very cool. I always wondered that.
Oh, and there's one more thing I have to do. I didn't do a proper laugh last time. There are two laughs I have to give you. I don't want to dampen the recording. And the other laugh is the... Which is the one you hear in your ear in a dark alley as the stiletto goes in the other ear.
There you go. I'm saving those just so you know.
Of course.
And I'm taking the copyright and just putting them anywhere I want to in the podcast. So.
Sure, why not?
Well, actually, Gary Dallison had a second part to that question over the dragon. He was talking about, he'd like to know about animal livestock in the realm. So we have the Roth and their varieties, but what about the realm's equivalent of sheep, goats, chickens? Names would be useful unless they're just sheep, goats, and chickens.
Well, there are indeed sheep, goats, and chickens.
Okay.
Because the problem with having many hands at work on the realms is that people who were in a hurry or lazy or didn't have an imagination or just thought, no, I shouldn't create weird stuff and have to explain it. Let's have some things that you know, gamers and readers can pick up on, would put straight ahead familiar things in the realms right away. And they did. So they're in print right away from the beginning. So, yes, there are lots of horses. There are lots of oxen. There are lots of sheep. There are lots of boar, wild boar or hogs, you know. There are lots and lots of geese. There are ducks. There are, and I'm talking now about things that are used in agriculture as well as wild. And there are lots of chickens because people put them in right from the beginning. And in some of the early game design stuff, both in Dragon and in the D&D lines, I would put in something exotic and the editor would just chop it out and throw it on the floor. No, not interested. Who cares what they're eating? We need that space for adventure, which happened over and over again.
Well, and I have to admit, I ran into that too, and I started adopting the basic rule, which was if it occupies the same ecological niche as a rabbit and it doesn't need to be anything particularly different, let's just make it a rabbit and be done with it.
Yep.
And then you don't have to waste the space in explaining it.
Yep. Yeah. Word count was precious in the days of only print.
That said, you can. There are a few uniquely realms animals that sort of play those traditional livestock roles that have snuck into various products. I know. Ed gave us the Serpus Roth. I think that first appeared in Drow of the Underdark. Mm-hmm. There was also. I always thought of them as an Underdark race, but right from the beginning, you also had a surface variety of them. In FR5, The Savage Frontier, there's an obscure mention to Shaggan, which are sort of seemed to me like a cross between bison and cattle that wander the plains of the Deseran River Valley. And in Troy Denning's Return of the Archwizards trilogy, there's a reference to Therk, I think I'm pronouncing that correctly, which Ed, you told me once was a barbarian word actually that the elves had adopted. And that refers to probably you'd call it a variety of sheep that produces some incredible wool that the elves use in their high quality garments. So yeah. there are creatures around. There's even, I think Ed, you snuck it into the Menzo Baranzen box set. I think it's, George, correct me if I get this wrong, it's a Cathlier, which is sort of the same family as a peacock, but there's an obscure reference to the feathers being for sale in the markets of Menzo Baranzen. So if you look carefully, you can find the occasional reference that didn't get cut, and then if you stop mentioning the common ones, all of a sudden you've really transformed what the animal life in the setting looks like. Just as a thought.
And there's also, there's stuff that, had been thought of and either there wasn't room for it or it was cut for other reasons. I just got reminded for some reason of something I'd wanted to do if I was allowed to do any expansion with the Omnian colonies over in Mastika, was to make kind of one of the larger livestock, instead of there being sheep over there, I was going to do some sort of variant of the capybara. And that's
sure,
sort.
Yeah, but, giant yeah. rodents, yeah, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Those things in the Deseran Valley, picture muskox, then give them much lighter coats, and then give them feet that are as big as dinner plates that flare out, because then they don't sink in bog or mud. It's like they're wearing their own snowshoes all the time.
I love that image.
I think at Candlekeep, you mentioned a particular mountain goat, Ed, called a Corrinthorn or Mountain Corrin, which was, and I've seen pictures of these, so they exist in the real world. They've got four forward-pointing horns.
Yep.
Two that go up and two that go down, I think, I think that's the description. And you've got those, you mentioned those in one of your Candlekeep posts. So there are a few, as everyone said, things floating around that have managed to avoid edits or you've managed to mention in terms of livestock that isn't standard that we wouldn't find necessarily here in the real world.
Yeah, you need stuff ecologically, because what do all those orcs eat? I know, each other, but... but I mean, they would have realistically something they could herd if there was something there. And if you put mountain goats, and when somebody says, well, where the hell would they go? You just pointed all the mountains and said, all over the mountains. You know, they can stand on ledges that we would slide off of, shrieking in horror and tumble to our deaths. So they can be all over the mountains. And you have to do this if you're thinking about the balance of life in the realms. You're always thinking, so where does the food come from? Where does the food come from? You know, and therefore there have to be a lot of critters that get called, could be categorized as livestock, as in people, even if they don't breed them or feed them deliberately the way humans do, if you're like orcs, you herd them in a mountain valley and make sure they can't leave, except into your tummies.
And not even, you know, thinking even smaller than livestock. I mean, I just had this hideous thought of, what if the realm's version of a raccoon had just a hair bit more intelligence than the ones that we have in our world? And because they're scary smart here, those little trash pandas. Imagine what they could do over there.
Yeah.
I think Ed on Twitter just said something along those lines. Didn't you come across with some sort of mini race? I can't recall exactly what they were, but I'll have to check now.
Let me just open the thing.
You came up with, I think they were basically bipedal mice, big ones, rodents. As you are wont to do.
Yes, well, hey, I create things. That's what I do.
You didn't call them R-O-U-S's, did you?
But now I'm wondering, Ed, given that George lives on the continent of killer animals, everything is out to kill you there, no matter how small.
That's not true. That's an exaggeration.
No, it's not.
He lives so where in is the that land in the under, which is obviously where the drow live.
Exactly. Are you looking that up, Ed?
No, I gave up.
Oh, okay. That's all right. So let's go on to our...
The file's too big. The file's too big. Hmm?
Oh, is it? Okay. All right, let's go on to the next one. If you can find it, George, on Twitter, that'd be great.
Yeah, I'm trying to track it down. It's just my internet's very slow at the moment. Oh. Anyway, I'll get there.
No worries. I have one here from Deserk, another one from Candlekeep. And he is, and this goes back to Races of Faerun, which is written by Eric Boyd, Matt Forbeck, and James Jacobs. And I say those names because Matt has actually agreed to come onto our podcast.
All right.
Yeah, so we're going to have Matt Forbeck on at some time in the beginning of next year. When he's actually in the States for long enough to do it. And it says here, the races of Faerun spoke of there being Orog cities. Not just settlements, but cities in the Underdark. Are there possibly any specific Orog nations or city-states that any Forgotten Realms designer could talk about?
Let me just read this aloud. Sujar, S-U-J-A-R, but pronounced Sujar, is an Orog city. Located in the Yehimal Mountains, due east of Dralpur. Quite a ways due east of Dralpur. Orogs call the mountains, those mountains, which are honeycombed with natural water seepage caverns that connect with the Underdark, of course, they call that mountain range Orthar, O-R-T-H-A-R, which means rock home. Remember, they speak a dialect of Jotun, the giant language. And Sujar is the largest Orog city along the range. Far to the south along the range are rival cities Ruraja, which is R-U-R-A-J, and southeast of it, Braloch, which is B-R-A-L-O-C-H. There you go! And that's what I have off the top of my... Uh-huh.
Okay, and anybody else? Eric, since you wrote the book?
I did not write that piece.
So we'll blame it on Matt.
If I was going to guess, I would probably say there's at least one hidden, perhaps under the mountains to the west or east of the Moon Sea, that is somewhat tied into the history of the Great Grey Land of Thar. That seems like the most likely place in the realms to me. The realm... You know, just like Ed was talking earlier about the realms not being, or, you know, as different designers have done it, they've, you know, put chickens and sheep. They also have a tendency to throw ogres and orcs and goblins and gnolls every which where and the like, since we're speaking of races of Faerun, my feeling was always that this is not something where I would contradict existing lore, but in her, you know, sometimes you can accomplish the same effect by emphasizing bits of lore. I always tried to think through what were the migration patterns of the different races. So to me, you know, the gnolls are best suited to be found in the Shar and the Eastern Shar and up in Thay, but also up near Frozen Flindyke and the Moon Sea. But I don't tend to put gnolls up in the Savage North, for instance, or in Kalimshan. You can always explain them away with portals. But likewise with ogres and related beasts, and I would throw Orogs in that category. To me, the most likely place that they were racially concentrated is around the Moon Sea. And so that would be my temptation, is to put them up there.
All right, great. Anybody else?
Nope, not really. I mean, I was just having a stray thought about, maybe gnolls don't exist in the Savage North because trolls find them too tasty. I mean, is that ever really discussed of which monstrous humanoids feed on which other monstrous humanoids?
Sounds like it's worthy of a book, A Recipe of Gnolls.
My favorite gnoll dishes.
Yes, brought to you by Goblin McOrc Snacker.
Don't get me started.
That is not a real realm's name. Do not take that as something that belongs in the realms.
Too late.
Steven, would you want to come back and do some more?
No, he's gone.
And that's a no. That's a no. And he's down.
I'm sorry, I'm talking without my microphone on. Yeah, I would love Schend to come back, sure. We just have to juggle the schedules, that's all.
I love it. Steven Schend out.
What, I gotta go away now? What?
No, that's fantastic. No, we'd love to have you back. This has been wonderful. Okay.
Just gotta say, I miss you guys. Love you all. So,
we do miss you too.
See you all before Christmas.
I wish we could have gone to the Game Hole Con this year. I would have loved to have gone.
Yeah. Brian bought some good beers from San Diego.
So. Did he really? I should have brought you back with the beers I got in Germany. You would have loved it.
Oh yeah.
I went to Ondex in just below about an hour south of Munich, and they've been brewing beer since the 400s.
Oh, so they probably have it right by now. Yeah.
Yeah, I think they do, and they're a bunch of monks who believe that drinking beer is the way to God. So. I have to agree with him.
That's my sort of religion.
Exactly. I get behind that, right? No, that would be wonderful. And Steven, I'll probably ask him before Curry does. If you want anybody wants to get a hold of you, then just get a hold of you at Candlekeep or Facebook or.
Yeah, I'm on both, though. I have to admit I haven't been to Candlekeep regularly for a while, but if I start getting more questions there, I guess I will pop back over there. But I'm on Twitter under my own name, Stephen E. Schend, and I'm on Facebook, same thing. I think I've got an Instagram account, but I'm not sure. And Pinterest, all that jazz, but maybe I ought to trim back some of that, who knows. But eventually, I'll also be resurrecting StephenEShen.com and making more out of that. So.
Oh, that'd be fantastic. I think you should make your own group of irregulars right now. So.
I'm irregular enough, thank you.
The irregular illiterates, right? Or illiterates. That should be an A, not an I, just so you know.
Oh, I understand. All right, well, are we calling it night, gentlemen?
Yeah, I think we're going to. Just wanted to say stopping point, yeah. Thanks, everybody, for coming on. I appreciate it.
Thanks,
I'm so sorry it's been so long, but life got in the way with my house being rebuilt and everything, so the inside, so.
But it's great to see all you guys again. Hi!
Yeah.
Hi! And Ed is about 95% now, I think, right?
Wow.
That's a resounding no.
I know that feeling, man. I feel you.
Well, hugs and kisses to Jenny and Sharon and Tish and I'm blanking on George's wife's name, who I've never met, so I shouldn't say
that. Antoinette.
Antoinette.
The better half.
That's right.
Give our best to Sarah too, Stephen.
Yes, please.
Yeah, absolutely, Stephen.
Okay, yep. You guys take care. We'll talk soon.
Okay, all right, guys. Fantastic. Thanks for that.
Thanks.
All right.
See ya. Thanks. Bye.
Thanks.
Bye. To thank you for joining us here at Mages and Sages Interview with the Old Mage with our special guest of Stephen Schend. Join us next time. Hopefully we're going to have a special program that we're going to put together with some friends we met at Gen Con. Until then, keep playing in the realms.